Oh. Hi mate, how you doing?
Yeah, not too bad, Ollie. I just got a bit of a problem and I was wondering if you could help me out.
Fire away.
Okay, so you know I'm on Intelligent Octopus Go, the EV tariff from Octopus Energy, and it's great. It's absolutely great. And I've got my home battery charging overnight between 11:30 p.m. and 5:30 a.m. But what I'm finding is that Octopus Energy is giving me extra charging slots throughout the day. And whenever that happens, I'm finding that my home battery is actually discharging into my EV. And I was wondering if there's anything I could do about it. And of course, I thought of you because you're an expert on Home Assistant and maybe there's a solution there. What do you think?
Yeah, that is definitely something that Home Assistant can help us with. And I'm pretty sure we can come up with an automation to sort that for you. But before we go down the Home Assistant route, you're aware that you could lose hours, if not days, of your life to playing with Home Assistant. Have you checked with Mrs. Gary Does Solar that that's okay first?
I've not checked yet, but I will do. I'll make sure that's all kosher before we proceed. But I do know that there is a little bit of a learning curve with Home Assistant, and maybe with your help, we can reduce that as much as possible.
Yes, certainly. So can I just check? You've got Give Energy batteries, haven't you?
Yeah, that's right. I've got a Give Energy inverter and two 9.5 kilowatt hour batteries.
Perfect. And you want the batteries to charge at the same time as your EV is charging. You don't want it to just pause the batteries. You actually want them to charge up and use that cheap energy at the same time.
Yeah, that would be perfect for me, Ollie.
So Home Assistant needs to run on a computer that is powered on all of the time so as it can run the automations anytime that it needs to. Have you got any hardware or computer that's already on all of the time in your house?
So I don't have any spare PCs. I do have a Synology hard drive, and I think it can run apps, but I prefer not to use that. A standalone solution would be ideal for me if that's possible.
Yeah, sounds like a Raspberry Pi might be a good idea for you, at least to start with. So I tell you what I'll do is I'll go and look on Amazon and I'll come up with a shopping list for you and send it over. And then you can get those bits together, assemble them, and we can take it from there.
Sounds great, Ollie. Looking forward to it. Thank you.
Brilliant. All right. Speak to you soon.
Yeah. Cheers then, Ollie. Bye-bye.
All right. Suppose I better get ready. Right. That's better. Time to get to work. So Gary's project is going to require him to buy a bit of hardware, so I thought I'd go through the shopping list with you that I've put together for him, so as you know what all the parts are for and why I have specifically chosen them. So he's going to need to run Home Assistant on a computer somewhere on his home network. That computer has to be left on all of the time. Now you can use something you already have if you want. Maybe you've got a NAS that's on all of the time already, but I've chosen a Raspberry Pi for Gary. Specifically, this is a brand new Raspberry Pi 5 that I've not even had a play with yet, and there are a number of reasons for choosing a Raspberry Pi to run Home Assistant. Firstly, it's low power. It draws under 3 watts when idle and about 7 watts when under stress, so it's not going to waste too much energy. Secondly, it's very easy for beginners to get up and running. The reason for that is almost self-fulfilling because there are so many Raspberry Pi users out there that the hardware is very well supported. And because it's so well supported, more people get Raspberry Pis. There's a version of Home Assistant available just for the Raspberry Pi, and chances are most of the software bugs and compatibility issues will have already been discovered by someone else in the community. Thirdly, if your Raspberry Pi was to break, then it's usually easy to get hold of an exact replacement that you can just swap over. And restoring backups is made easy too, because it's the same hardware. I've chosen the version of the Pi with 4 GB of RAM for Gary. You don't really want any less than that, because future software demands always tend to increase, but 4 GB should be plenty for the foreseeable future. There's no harm in going for the 8 GB version though if you want, it's just a bit more expensive. Next, we need some storage. Now you can use regular micro SD cards, but because Home Assistant is regularly writing to the disk, saving sensor values and that sort of thing, the life of your micro SD card can be dramatically reduced. And when the SD card fails, Home Assistant will crash never to be seen again. It's much better to use a proper solid-state drive. Now the Raspberry Pi 5 supports NVMe storage, so I have picked out a reasonably priced 1TB drive from WD. This is way more storage than you are likely to ever need, but I've chosen this specific model for a reason I'll go into shortly. Now you can't just plug the NVMe drive straight into the Raspberry Pi. The connector on the board isn't the correct size or shape for that. So what I've done is find a special case for the Raspberry Pi that converts that for you. This is the Argon 1 V3 NVMe PCIE case for the Raspberry Pi 5. I've actually got the older version 2 of this case and it's been brilliant for a few years. The SSD slots very neatly into the underside of the case, so as you end up with one compact and neat unit. The reason I chose this specific model of SSD is because it's listed on the case's known compatible list, and I didn't want Gary to have to go through the hassle of finding out that a cheaper SSD doesn't work with this case. In theory, most NVMe SSDs are likely to work, I think, if you wanted to try your luck with something cheaper. Now we need to power the thing. The Raspberry Pi needs a USB-C power supply rated at 27 watts. There are quite a few available that meet that need, and I chose a safe-looking one from GeeekPi on Amazon. And lastly, and I know this part is a bit of a waste because you are literally going to use it once to get things up and running, but you need an enclosure for your SSD. Again, these are a bit of a commodity on Amazon, but I found this one from UGREEN for him because I have this exact same one myself already, so I know it works well. You are going to use this enclosure to put your SSD in and connect it to your computer. You'll then download and run the Raspberry Pi Imager software from the Raspberry Pi website to install Home Assistant straight to the SSD. When that's done, you'll pop the SSD out and put it in the Argon 1 case instead, ready for your first time boot up of Home Assistant. Anyway, I will put the full list of links for this shopping list down in the video description, so as you can go and check them out for yourself. To find out how Gary gets on with all of this kit, you'll need to wait for his video to come out on his channel in a few weeks. When that does come out, I'll put a link in the description to it for you. And if you want to find out the details of the automation I'm putting together for him, then make sure you subscribe so as you don't miss that in a few weeks. I'll give the video a like too while you're there. A massive thank you to my channel members and patrons listed here for supporting the channel. If you'd like to support the channel, then in return for joining as a member or a patron, I'll give you early access to my videos and some bonus behind the scenes content. Check out the links to Patreon and channel membership down in the description if you're interested. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.